So good evening. I hope I'm not going to lose my voice. You know, as you can hear, I'm French, so you may have sometimes a bit of difficulty to understand me. I do apologize for that. But I'd like to share a little bit of my experience in supply chain and in operations. So first of all, a quick word on GE. I think you all have heard about GE. So GE, it's a $120 billion company. So out of which we have $55 billion in service activity and $65 in product activities. So we have a very balanced portfolio between aviation, power, renewable, energy connections, transportations, healthcare. Actually, we produce tons of things that are totally different. And it starts with the small things like a blood pressure cuff, up to a gas turbine or even a steam turbine that weigh around 400 tons. So it's really a fantastic spectrum of what you can produce in the world. And it's an interesting thing. We are very advanced in terms of technology. So first of all, I'd like to start about a little bit of the way we look at the supply chain going forward. And actually, you're pretty lucky or unlucky. I don't know yet. But I really believe that there is going to be a massive change in the supply chain in the next 10 years. And a change which is most certainly much bigger than the changes that have happened in the last 40 years. And the reason why is simply two things. One is the power of analytics, and the second is additive technology. So let me start with additive technology, because I think that's something that people don't yet perceive how it's going to work and what will be the influence on the world. Additive technology, I'm going to take one example, just that you understand it. What you can do with additive technology is that you take a system of 20 parts that you will merge into one part, because instead of building it from 20 parts, you will be able to print it in 3D printing in one part. Before, you had 5 to 10 suppliers working on the 20 parts that were sending you the parts in your factories and you were assembling the parts. And that's not going to exist anymore. Then you had a group of 20 engineers, highly specialized in each and every part, who were designing the parts. And that's going to be designed by one engineer. And then you will be able to produce this part at the point of use. So what that means, in a nutshell, is that, first of all, you will be able to design parts and produce parts within a very short time, where before you had 2 to 3 months of development, it's going to be a week or 2 weeks. Second, all the logistics around those parts will simply disappear because you won't move them anymore. And finally, so you will be able to make a lot of change on your parts to improve it and to redesign it quickly and get it close to your customer immediately. So you may think it's a little bit of science fiction. I can tell you it's not. We are actually having parts like the fuel nozzles that are on our aircraft engine. And this is the way we develop them. So this is a part which were before a system of 16 parts. And with the new technology and the efficiency that we were looking for the engine, we couldn't design it with the old technology. So our engineers said, OK, let's do it in 3D printing. And actually, the result in 3D printing was we developed it faster, it's cheaper, and the efficiency of the part is way bigger. So that's what additive will bring. So now you would say, yes, but additive will destroy the entire economy. Right? I don't think so. I don't think so, because additive will enable each and every of you to create your own stuff quickly. Today, if you want to go into the supply chain work, if you want to create a new company which is product related, not something which is only pure software, you will struggle because you have cost of toolings. It's going to cost a lot of money to invest into the equipment. With 3D printing, you will be able to do it. And from the idea to the generations of the product, it's going to take a couple of weeks or maybe a couple of months, when today it's a couple of years. So the economy will be totally different. And you, because you're young, not me, not Nelson, but you will see it. And I'll be retired, and I will count on you to make it happen. But I think it's going to be a real, real change. And I'll be happy to discuss that with you after. The second thing that I'd like to convey is, you know, very often people forget operation or supply chain, whatever you want to name it. That's a huge mistake. That's a huge mistake. Every strategy, even the best strategy, even the best product, if it's not executed well, will never be successful. Operations is really a key element of a strategy. It's a part of it. It's not something a lot of people consider, and you have had a lot of trends where people were divesting their own supply chain. They were saying, especially in the, I would say, printed in the PWA areas, in the electronics areas. But that's not right. Supply chain is a big part of your strategy. It can help you to really make, differentiate yourself in terms of market positioning. I'm losing more and more my voice. I hope you still hear me. So I'd like to tell you what we're doing today in GE with the supply chain. So first of all, we have launched an initiative that we call the Brilliant Factory. So for us, Brilliant Factory is four things. One, which is the base, it's lean. Applying lean in our factories. The second is digitization, the digital part of it. The third is advanced manufacturing. This is everything which is robotics, cobots, Google glasses, all those type of things. Exoskeleton, you name them. And fourth, it's additive. Today, we're focusing on the first two steps, lean and digital, because we consider this to be the most important at the moment. Even so, we are very strong in additive. So what we try to do is, GE has 540 factories all over the world. If you put all together the square feet of the factories, it's exactly the size of Manhattan. So that's a lot of people. It's 120,000 people. So we have launched a program where we ask each and every factory to assess themselves according to our brilliant, what we call the Brilliant Factory Matrix. And the Brilliant Factory Matrix is a matrix with five levels of lean and five levels of digitization. And they have guidelines to assess themselves. And we try to get them to the level 4.4. The amazing thing is that when you start to speak about lean, even in a company like GE, where people would say, so it's a great company, more than 64% of our factories are below level 2.2, which is average, which is very average in terms of lean. And this is something that we are working on, so to really redevelop the lean concept in GE. And I just would like to highlight the fact that lean is a basic. If you don't have this basic, it doesn't make any sense to digitize your processes because you are digitizing waste. And I used to say to my team, if you digitize shit, you get shit, right? And that's really true. So I have multiple experiences where I can demonstrate that this is the case. So what we're doing at the moment is we're pushing this Brilliant Factory. We have seven showcases all around the world that are now at level 4.4, where you have digitizations and lean together. And that's extremely powerful. And I think that's maybe something which is a bit different from the lean, let's say, in terms of what Toyota is doing, because the digitizations really bring something. And I'm coming back to analytics, because with digital, you can capture data. And more we are able to capture data in our factories. We get all the machines connected. We get all the workstations connected. And we're able to capture those data and run analytics on it. And we are able to find things that we couldn't find in the past. So I know that some of you have most certainly been through some Six Sigma training. But even with Six Sigma NG, and we've been big in Six Sigma, we couldn't get and leverage Six Sigma well enough because we were lacking of data. Thanks to digitization, so we have the data. We can capture the data. And we can really work on it. So again, it's brilliant factory model with lean, with digitizations can really accelerate the progress and can really accelerate the productivity. The seven showcases that we have built today, they have all the same patterns in terms of results. We have been able to reduce their lead time by 50%, 50. We have reduced the inventory, the work in progress, between 30 and 80%. We have improved the productivity by 25%. And we have reduced the square, the space needed by 50%. So if you take about 540 factories, and if you reduce your space, the space that you need, by 30%, so you can reduce your numbers of factory by 200. This is pretty much the ratio. So again, so there is a lot of possibilities still with lean and digitization. And the beauty of that is that it never stops. And I think the good example is Toyota. Because all over those years, they never stop progressing with lean. They always try to do a bit more. It works. GE has been the counterexample of it. In 1995, we launched demand flow technology, which was lean, actually, the same. You know, Kaizen, whatever the name you want to give it, it was the same. And then we said, 5 years later, oh, we're done with it. And then everything went back to square one. Our turns, inventory turns went down. So again, so it's a never-ending story. So one of the takeaways is that lean never stops and should never stop. So this is a journey where you are always to go through all your life and all the life of the company. And Toyota is a very good example. Now, we spoke about lean, we spoke about digitizations, we spoke about the impact of additive. I think all of that will make, again, the world different. And I think GE is really trying to tackle this. So as I told you, we are investing in lean and digital. GE has made a huge move to digital. So we have hired thousands of IT engineers to develop new technology with the Predix platform, which help us to really build an operating system on which you can start to use and take the benefits of everything which is related to matching machine learning or artificial intelligence. So we are building a true platform that we try to spread across the industry, and it starts to work. The second thing is we are investing heavily in additive. Only last year, only in 2016, we have acquired ServiceMax, which is a big software provider. We have acquired Meridium, which is also a software provider. We have acquired Concept Laser, which is an additive company. And we have acquired Arcam Laser, which is another additive company. So really, GE is pushing this additive story and digital story to the end. And we really believe that it's going to be a new business model. So I leave you with that. You're in front of a big change in the supply chain world. And there are many things that are going to change. And the best way to be prepared to get there is to be lean upfront. It will help you to really cope with those huge moves that additive and digital will bring. And it may happen much faster than everybody thinks. And I'm sure you will see it. You will see it. Most certainly in the next 10 years. So, before I lose totally my voice.
Okay, so we'll start with a couple of questions before opening up to the audience. So could you maybe provide a specific example of implementing ideas of lean operations in GE?
Yes, I can give you. We are producing compressors, big compressors, you know, those big things that you have in the oil and gas industry. Those big compressors, we were looking at it and we looked at what is the customer demand, what the customer wants in terms of delivery time. And the customer wants 6 months from the time they place the order to the time they actually get the product. And we looked at our lead time. And our lead time was 2 years. So to get, to be able to deliver in 6 months, what you do is you build inventory. If you build inventory, it's a cash trap. So you're not generating the cash. So we have worked on the lead time of this, and only in the factory side, by the way. So just to make it extremely simple. In one of our factories in Florence, and we say to the manager there, we told him, we said, look, Davide, today you have center of excellence. You're doing machining here, you're doing fabrications here, you're doing painting here, you're doing assembly in this shop. So you have 4 different shops and you have an assembly line. You're going to put everything in line. You will put your machining into the assembly line. You're going to connect all the processes. The guys look at us and he says, impossible. He says, simply impossible. And I think Jim was there, and that's, the guy said, no. Today, all those processes are connected. Lead time reductions, 80%. 80%. Space floor reductions, 50%. WIP reductions, 80%. And on top of that, he gets productivity, quality improvement, because as the processes are connected, you cannot let your quality going in the wrong direction. You have to act immediately. So by connecting the processes, you force the organization to really look at what are the root cause of the issue that you have on the line. It's now a pull system when it was a push system. And then he can free up cash to invest into new product. But the most important thing is about people engagement. In this factory, a year and a half ago, when you were going through the factories, people were going away from you when you were visiting the factory and try to hide behind their machines and everything. No, they're on the line and they ask to come to show you that what they have done. And I think the level of engagement of the team has increased tremendously. So that's an example.
So just in building upon that, I think one of the things we talk about this continuous improvement culture, but what was it that enabled the change to actually occur when the initial idea was this is impossible, and suddenly a year later things have dramatically changed at these factories?
The way we did it is we have a number of lean leaders in GE who really know it. They have done it. And they went to the factory with the management there, and they say, so look, this is the way it could work. And they work with the team. They worked also with the shop floor people to really make it happen. And the shop floor people could also give their input in the way the workstation were built. And they simply applied the simple lean techniques. You know, I don't know if you have heard about 3P, Yamizumi, and those kind of things. And that's very simple. It's common sense. It's not more than common sense. And just trying to reduce waste and eliminating waste. And it works very well. But we had somebody who knew that it was working. And then a big management pressure too.
I was hoping that maybe you could also expand on the discussion of how analytics is being used to complement these lean initiatives. So you were mentioning that it was quite different than the notion of how Toyota was using lean. So maybe a concrete example might help us to understand better how that's happening.
I'll tell you one example which is extremely interesting. I have two examples. So I'll take the first one, which is a bit more complex one. As I said at the beginning, so $55 billion of our business is a service business. So what we do is we get aircraft engine back to our shop, or engine from locomotive back in our shops, or we have to do an outage of a gas turbines. And now, thanks to analytics on those equipment, we're able to identify which part is going to fail. Therefore, when the engine or the aircraft engine is coming into our workshop, we already know what we need to change in it. This is what we call the digital twin. The digital twin is analytics on one hand and the physics on the other end. So that means to understand the failure mode of your other part. And with this, we're able to see while the aircraft engine is on the wing and flying, we can monitor it and we say, oh, when it comes back, this one, because it has been through, it has taken off that many times, it has been run this way, we understand what we need to do. And then we can reduce the scope of what we have to do in the shop. So that's one example where analytics really helps. The second one is a more conventional one. This is all about statistical process control. And, you know, this is something that people tend to forget. If you are able to monitor your process, if you are able to understand what are the trends of your process, what are the variations of your process, by capturing the data with a good gauge RNR, so you're able to monitor it. And what we're developing today is, for example, some condition-based maintenance tool that help us to understand if a machine is drifting. We're able to understand it, and we can ask the machine to correct itself and then plan for the next maintenance. This was not possible without analytics.
How do you think about the interactions between improving operations efficiency and customer needs in the context of your company?
Huge. So if I have one word, it's huge. Now, think about it. You know, if you apply Lean or the Brilliant Factory concept, it's all about killing waste. If you kill waste, you reduce the variation in your process. Then it's easier and easier for you to stick to the date, the delivery date that you have given to your suppliers with the right quality. So then you can really be a very, very robust and reliable partner for your customers. That's first. Second, because you're eliminating all the waste, you're able to reduce your costs. So then you can maybe do some trade-off with your customer and share part of the margin. So every time that you improve operationally, so it always improves your relations with the customer. Never the other way around.
So I was hoping that you could tell us a little bit more about the complexity of the global supply chain that GE is dealing with, and highlight what are some of the biggest challenges there, and what type of opportunities there may be for improvement.
There are tons of opportunities to start with. So that's the good thing. You know, that's the good thing. Again, as I stated at the beginning, we have 540 factories. I can tell you that's a lot. You know, even I'm visiting 1.5 factory per week, which is quite a bit, if you look at it, and it will take me something like 7 years to visit all of them. So it's a lot. So the complexity we have is as two sides. So first of all, because we organized in the past our shops by center of excellence rather than connecting the processes, we are machining a part somewhere that we will deliver to another factory which is going to assemble a part into a small system. And this system, you're going to ship it to a third factory and sometimes to a fourth and a fifth. And you have this equipment standing all over. And I'm going to take the example of the MRI, which is one of our equipment for healthcare. one MRI, if you take every part of the MRI and you just measure the numbers of miles that they are going to make before reaching the customer, what would be your guess? How many miles an MRI, which is, you know what an MRI is? So how many miles would you think this type of equipment will do before it reaches the customer?
60,000 miles?
Sorry?
60,000 miles.
60,000 miles?
260.
Because you have been part of the group, right? Yes, that's the thing. 260,000 miles. This is simply insane. This is simply insane. So this is where there is a lot of improvement to be done. So we can really, and it's not specific to GE, I can tell you. It's specific to the industry. And actually it's 264,359.
Great, so why don't we open it up to the audience if you guys have any questions. We have TAs with microphones going around, so just raise your hand and they'll bring the mic to you.
Hi, just now Professor Chan asked a question in terms of the global supply chain, and my question is regarding different businesses of GE. You know, we all know that GE has a lot of businesses, GE Aviation, Energy, Healthcare, and what's the synergy between different business units in terms of supply chain and operations? Thank you.
That's a good point. That's an interesting question. I would say there are three levels. One, it's more about human capital. So this is where we have synergies because we have people and managers moving from one business to the other to make sure that we get this improvement everywhere. And that's a big one. The second one, which is extremely important, it's about everything we are doing with our global research center. It's about material. How do you define the material? How do you create new material so that we can use into an environment like an aircraft engine and a gas turbine, because you are using the parts at the level of temperatures which is extremely high. So this is also part of it. And the third one is a more down-to-earth one, is that you know all those products have screws, washers, bolts, and you couldn't imagine the numbers of screws, washers, and bolts we have. I think there is not one single screw existing on Earth that we don't buy. So we're going through a huge wave of standardizations of those screws and bolts and things. But it's, you know, you may think it's nothing. But you know, if you add up all the screws, bolts, and washers that we buy every year, this is $350 million every year. And just by standardizing, this year we save $60 million. At least it paid my salary.
You mentioned the anecdote about how, you know, get some linear operator going and fix the one factor, make it way more productive. But in subsequent, you were talking about how, you know, there's 260,000 miles between, you know, full production. So, like, how do you guys, and I presume you do an analyze, how do you analyze and decide when does it make sense to take two of those certain factories, compare them together, and just make that one whole line, make it more productive in that sense?
It's always, so the way we look at it, it's always according to the customer needs. So where is the customer? And, you know, we are actually, GE is, you know, 75% of our engines, aircraft engines, 75% of our gas turbines are sold outside of the US, for example. And we have a big request from the different countries to localize. So this is the main driver. So where do we need to put the productions to be able to sell in those countries? Which, by the way, creates also jobs in the US because you know there are some sub-components that we're doing. But we always look at the customer. So where is the customer and how do we build the supply chain from there? Then the second thing is we look at waste. It says if we have three factories that are doing pretty much the same things, inefficiently, we try to combine those to make sure that we will get something which is efficient and with less waste. So We have a number of criteria that we looked at, so to make sure that we are looking at the footprint that we have in the correct way and to optimize it. You cannot always optimize it, so you have to find some solutions. But it's an iterative process. So we go, but it's always customer driven at the end of the day. This is where you want to sell.
I have a question. GE has an oil and gas operations segment that is basically like providing compressors and pumps for oil and gas operations. They recently acquired Baker Hughes as well. Can you please talk about the plans for operations optimization in a couple of years for GE, especially in the oil and gas business? Because that is something that, I mean, I'm sure it needs a lot of improvement at the moment to have the industry run smoothly.
So first of all, I cannot speak about so what we plan to do because the merger is not effective yet. So that's one thing. But the idea behind is so to be able to provide to our customers, the Shell of the world, the Conoco of the world, the British Petroleum of the world, a one-stop shopping from a service standpoint. So that's from extracting the oil to the refinery, so being able to deliver every type of equipment that they have, and with a software solutions that help them to get as efficient as they can. And we're developing a lot of applications at the moment that will be used with Baker Hughes and with us, with GE, so to really optimize the processes of the oil industry. The interesting thing is that 5 years ago, we would have proposed that to them. They would have said, so we don't care. At $100 a barrel, we have no need of your stuff. At 50, they start to speak. So the idea of this merger is really to create a big providers that goes wing-to-wing solutions for our customers.
Thank you. Thank you for taking the time to come and speak with us today. Can you talk a little bit about how GE prioritizes, I guess, some of the lean and digital technologies that they're implementing to deal with sustainability issues, and how do you kind of rank and prioritize whether it's, I guess, people waste versus, I guess, environmental waste, if you will?
What you say is interesting because we were, you know, in lean, we speak a lot about 5S, and now we're speaking about 6S, so for the sustainability side of it. So we are doing a lot of effort in terms of, first, health and safety for the people. And we had a bad year last year, so to be candid. And we think, and I had all my supply chain leaders with me in Orlando last week, and Anne Klee, who is our EHS leader for the group, was there to pitch and say, so what do we need to do to improve? So in terms of health and safety. From a waste management standpoint, I think we are pretty good. We are working pretty strongly on, you know, we have our all Eco Imaginations programs that is running for many years now, which is bringing not only on the supply chain side, but also on the product that we are delivering to our customers to eliminate any hazardous product, any type of product that could harm the environment. So we have done a lot of things there. So we are very strong in wind, as you know. So we're pushing these things a lot. So this is one of our fastest growing business right now. So it went up 11% last year. So this is the program is well on track, and we continue to develop. And lean and sustainability goes very well together because it's both on both sides waste elimination. So,
hi. So we spoke about lean, digitizing, and automating processes and supply chain. And my question is more on the people side of things. usually when you try to launch those projects, they start to become more synonymous. Oh, here we go again, we're leaning out on improving process. That's gonna mean more elimination of work, more elimination of roles and jobs. So how do you get your employees excited not only to propose improvement and efficiency ideas, but also motivated to execute them, even if it means that they could potentially lose their job or some of their colleagues may not have a role anymore?
So first of all, I think there is a bit of a change of mindset of the people because everybody realized that we're in an unsecured environment and that your job is not there forever if you don't do the necessary improvement. So that's one thing. And I think that started to, in most of the cases, I have to say in our factories, that's more the mindset today. The second thing that I can tell you is that everywhere we have really implemented Lean, everywhere the employees are really involved in the change. So the change are done according to what they think and not push on them, but this is they're really participating to the change. And the level of engagement is absolutely incredible. I was last week in UK in one of our aviation factory, and I can tell you, so this is really, they are really doing well in Lean. And you cannot believe the engagement of the people there. And it's a unionized factory. So it's not a factory which is not unionized. It's a unionized factory. And I have never seen this type of level of engagement. And all of that is thanks to Lean, because Lean is much more transparent than anything else. Because if you go into a Lean factory, you will see everywhere the boards of what is going to happen on the production, so what is the load that is going to be in the next 6 months or 12 months. It's extremely transparent. So the people are much more confident. They really believe and they really trust their management, and they can challenge the management. So it's working very well. I think Lean is helping a lot on the engagement of people, I can tell you.
Building on that question, so what are the, you know, Lean is such a powerful idea, but it's a simple idea, right? So what are the main obstacles in Lean implementation? So I was actually wondering what happened to the guy in the compressor factory who said no.
He has been promoted, by the way. No, but really, he has been promoted in its own factory. So that's... I think it's always a matter, you know, Lean, people have heard so much about it. It's a matter of having people who can demonstrate that it works. It's really, I think this is really the key. If you have somebody that comes in your factory and say, apply Lean without giving guidance, without having a sensei that comes and help you to set up the things, and without two or three people that really start to believe in it and are pushing it, it's very difficult to start. But if you have really somebody who really knows how to do it and with the team can have a successful pilot, then the things are coming. And it's, I can tell you, this factory in Florence, they had this pilot on this line, but now they're doing that for the entire factory. And amazingly, the workers are asking for it. Because you say, why this line is nice and clean, it's easy to work in, there is no waste, the quality is okay, and we're still struggling with the old way of doing the things. Let's do it here. So I think it's a matter of having people who understand it, know it, can demonstrate that it works, and then it goes, because at the end of the day, it's pure common sense. But you need to have also, at the top level of the organization, people telling, so look guys, this is the way to go. We'll continue. It's not the flavor of the day. It's a way that we want to develop, and this is the way we want to work for the next, I don't know, 10, 20, 30, 40 years.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. I have an immediate follow-up question. So because you mentioned supply chain and Lean implementation in GE factories sometimes require lean implementation in the supply chain? So there are your suppliers or your supplier's suppliers. Mm-hmm. Are they doing it? If they are not doing it, then it will be very difficult for you to do lean.
That's not really true, actually. I think my view is that you have always the need to clean up the mess in your own factories before you start to say to the suppliers what they have to do. It works much better than if you ask them to do something and you don't do anything in your own factory. And you have ways to cope with that. So what we do is we do it in our factories, and then we start to work with the suppliers, and we start to implement milk run. We start to bring them, and we say, look, this is your cycle time, your lead time today. This is where we want you to be, because this is our goal. And then if you link your goal with their goal, that's going to be a good thing. And then sometimes they need help. So either we can do it, but today we don't have enough resources to do it, or we can also help them to get the right consultant to put that in place. And by coming into our factories, showing the result, seeing the results, so they are able to do it in their own factories. We have a very good example in China. We have a very good example in China, where our suppliers, so all the inventory is owned by the suppliers, and it's in FIFO and in Kanban at the beginning of each and every line, on the line. And there is a milk run, 50 kilometers, 500 kilometers, 1,000 kilometers. But we started internally first.
I had the opportunity to work on several supply chain projects. So from my experience, I saw that most of the times, inefficiencies in supply chain was not caused by the operational capabilities, but it was the lack of communication between stakeholders inside of the company, like sales, marketing, and operation, and even like conflict of interest. So how GE addressed this?
I think it's an extremely good question, by the way. So this is a disconnect that we found in GE. You know, one of the big things that we're doing at the moment is inventory reductions within GE. Our performance in inventory is, I would say, below average. So the GE turns for the company is, and it's a public information, it's 4.7 turns, which is a shitty performance. It is the way it is, so that's, and we're trying to improve that. And we have identified a number of levers. So the first one is really lead time reduction. So this is what we are really focusing on. So value stream map, wing to wing, lead time reduction, cycle time reductions, and value add ratio between value add and lead time. But another one of the levers, which is going to bring us something like $400 to $500 million of inventory reduction this year, is connecting the salespeople with the operation people. And having a standard format of what we call SNOP, this is sales and operations plan, operations planning, and really having pushing the people from sales and pushing the people from operations to formalize what they're doing. And that really helped, because there is no disconnect anymore. So they may not be right, they may be wrong, but at least they are wrong the same way. Before, they were wrong two times, which was increasing the inventory. Now they are wrong the same way. So that's, if they miss something, they miss it together. And it really helped. It really helped. So we are having this SNOP process, which is an old process, by the way, is extremely important. You have really to connect the sales with the operations. But it's a good question. It's true that it's screwing up most of the supply chain.
So a lot of your commentary has been sort of inward focused, mostly on GE, but you did mention drawing inspiration from Toyota. To what extent do you do benchmarking relative to your peers? And to the extent that you do it, what metrics are you looking at?
So we're doing some benchmark with some, especially with the automotive industry, like BMW, for example. I'll be with the BMW production leaders the two next days, so he's going to visit some of our factories. We have visited some of his factories. So we're exchanging on additives, we're exchanging also on digital. So we try to find some industries where we can have some view, something different. It can be a furniture factories, for example. So we have a lot of benchmark with a small companies close to Muskegon, where they have 200 turns. So every single component that comes into the factory one day goes out the next day. So I would love to have that. So that's, but we do a lot of benchmark and we try to. The good thing is that being GE, so people are really normally keen to benchmark. And I think that in most of the case, they think we are better than we are. So we learn a lot from them. But benchmark is key.
So you mentioned that you tour a lot of factories, once every week and a half, I think it was, or was it 1.5 per week?
1.5 per week, yes.
What are the things that you're looking for when you walk into one of GE's facilities in, say, the first 10 minutes, first 30 minutes that you're there, to make a call on whether they're a 2 or a 4 on, say, your lean index? What types of things are you keeping your eyes open for?
So it's extremely simple. It's extremely simple. When you enter into a factory, first you look at, is it clean? If it's not clean, you can say, okay, you're done. So that's one. Second, you say to the guy, the plant managers who normally try to bring you to the best spot of the factories, you say, no, I'm sorry. So I want to follow the flow. Let's go to the incoming inspection and let's go through the entire flow. If the guy has difficulty to find the flow, he's in trouble too. And you laugh, but it's very often the case, unfortunately, because the flow are not connected. Then the second is going into more details. And it's looking at each and every station, looking at the work in progress level into the factories, looking at each and every workstation and looking at, is it standardized? Do you have all the documentations on the workstation? Do you see that every part is easy to be used? Do you have shadow boards? Do you use Crayform? Those type of things. And finally, at the end of the day, you look at the visual management. Do you have the information in the factory? Then when you go through the factory, you can understand what is going on. That's key. I would say today, in 80% of the case in the world, you don't see anything. You don't really see the visual management. You don't really see the things. And when you're in a factory where the guy can bring you through the flow quickly because he understands it, he show you, you can really see from the indicators if it's going well or not. The fact that it goes wrong is okay, so that's life. But at least it's identified and it's clean, then it's a very good start. Then after you can go into the detail.
How have you applied the lean principles to your own personal life? And, do you tie your shoes more efficiently? And what have been some of the results?
You mean with my wife and my kids?
Sure, yeah.
So first of all, I have 7 kids. I have given up on lean principle. So that was not really an efficient process. It was a bit of a... So, and you know, this, I... The things I try to do and what I apply to my own life, and that's what I apply in my way to manage, and I can go out of the room and Jim can explain that to you too, is I try to eliminate waste. Everything that has no sense, makes no sense, I just don't do it. Because if it doesn't add value, I'm not going to do it. So this is what I'm looking for all the time. Can you simplify? Can you eliminate waste? And that's what I want to do, simply. And with these two principles, I think I'm a happy man. Not always, but most of the case. Simplification.
That's why you are not using PowerPoint.
That's also why I'm not using PowerPoint. I tried with my boss, it didn't work, so I...
Any more What do you think are the potential implications of widespread adoption of additive manufacture?
Sorry, of?
Of additive technology. And more generally, I mean, when you evaluate a very high-cost project, how do you account for its potential success? What is it that you're looking for?
You mean in terms, so, you know, the things at the end of the day, you always look at the value that you're generating, so the return on investment. Whatever is the amount of money that you're going to invest in a project, so you need to understand how quickly you will get back the money. So what we try to do and what the experience we have today is that every time that we apply the lean and digital, and we have now many, many instances, is we get a return on investment between 9 months and 15 months. And that's pretty much the ratio that we use. So if it's above 15 months, forget it. And below nine months, it starts to be suspicious. So that's are the numbers right? But we always look at that in terms of return on investment. The second thing is that we look at is what does it improve for your customer? Can you deliver faster? Because you have always to keep in mind the customer part of it. You know, everything on lean, we always keep in mind on lean that it's simplification, waste reductions, and those kind of things. But the true thing is that lean starts with the customer. This is exactly what it is. And every project in lean that doesn't start with somebody asks you, what is your customer need? So the guy is not a lean leader. He is not a lean leader, because he should normally tell you what is your customer needs, so what is the volume that he needs, when he needs to get it delivered. From there, you determine your tack time, and then you build your supply chain. But again, so in terms of KPI, so return on investment is clear. And second, so what does it make to, what the benefits for your customer?
Just to follow up. In the case of additive technology, one would expect that to be quite a disruption.
Yeah.
Right. So how would you assess in such a situation? I mean, but when you don't know how to look at.
No, this is the same. This is the same. Actually, let me share with you an experience on additive. Most of the people say, oh no, but additive is not that competitive. Because when I have a part that I do with a casting process and I want to print it, even so I reduce my lead time, it's very expensive. And in fact, this is the wrong concept. You can use additive and you can have a real return on investment if you take a system of part that you merge into one part that you will print. And that's something, if you have something to take away from additive, this is really it. Is you have a system of parts and you're gonna, from the system of part, 20 parts, you will build only one part. And then you have a big return on investment, even if you have to invest a lot to buy the 3D printing machines. But because you will save from an engineering standpoint, you will save from a logistics standpoint, and you will save from a cost standpoint. So that's really a big thing. So that you have always the same criteria, return on investment, but you have to be smarter. Any other questions? Two? I don't want to bore you too much. So that's,
I'm actually kind of a bit interested in the macro level of this discussion. So what you described in terms of additive technologies and analytics sounds nothing short to me but a revolution in the supply chain, but which might bring production back to the West, but not necessarily jobs. So I was interested, what is your view on this and how also is GE adapting in terms of workforce planning?
So first of all, today there are a lot of works that have been done by economists on what would be the impact of additive on the world. So because I'm optimistic, and as I told you, I have 7 kids, so I want to believe them. So they say that actually it will bring jobs. And they estimate that it will bring 12 million jobs in the world. Additional jobs. And again, so I think the principle of that is because you will be able to create more business, more things, because it will be easier to be done, so that would create some jobs. So There will be most certainly a period of time where we will be more on the productivity curve before going to the growth curve. So this is up to this. I think this is where the government will have a role to play. And to help the people to invest in those new technology, to develop new product, new way of producing things, new way, a new product that we cannot do today, and that we could do with 3D printing. But it's going to be, there will be, a, I think, a period of time where it's going to be a little bit difficult. But I do believe that there will be a real job creations with additive, like they have been with digital. The same.
I pretty much had the same question, but maybe I'll modify it a little bit. What you're saying is creative destruction, which is what economists love to say, but at least in the emerging market, something you see very often is lean production never gets implemented because of the job losses, and there's too much of a social externality, and people just choose not to do that. So with 540 factories around the world, how often have you just said, no, let's not make this production line lean because it's too hard to get the other factors sorted out?
I would say it's more the other way around. So either you are lean or you close. And again, the reason for that is because we eliminate waste and it's beneficial for the customers. And at the end of the day, it's beneficial for the people. Any other question?
I think maybe we can, in closing, ask you for a favor in our last question, in the sense that we're hoping maybe you could provide some advice to MBA students to get a sense of, you know, how important operations knowledge is part of the MBA education and career development more broadly. And I guess highlighting some of these things that you talked about, this mm-hmm. relationship between leadership and operations at GE and kind of more broadly.
So you have 2 hours or? No, let me share with you. So first of all, I think, you know, actually it's amazing, but you don't have a lot of people who really understand operation. Much less than what you could think. Really have a deep knowledge in operations. And how to improve a full supply chain, how to really make it efficient, how to eliminate waste, how to work on it. And I think if you are one of those, so your career path will be most certainly pretty steep and pretty quick. So I think it's really by knowing that, it's important. Again, in a business, you have two things that really matters. Growth, and growth includes your sales force, your ability to bring to the market new product quickly, and then operations. How do you make it happen? And if you don't have those two, you're never a great company. You're never a great company. So operations really matter. And then as a personal things, I would recommend for all of you. So first of all, to be curious. You know, be always curious. And especially in today's world, things are changing so fast that if you're not curious, if you don't look at the every evolutions of the supply chain or the operations of the sales of whatever, you're going to lose ground quickly. So be very curious. Always look at what is new, what does it mean. But keep in mind that being curious doesn't mean that you jump from one idea to the other. Is you just help to build your way in a very consistent way. That's the first thing. And the second thing that I would like you to go away with, and I think that's most certainly the most important, take care of people. Simply take care of people. We are in a very difficult world. You most certainly will be managers in the future. Maybe you will have to close factories. There are ways to do that. And there is very little chance that you would be able to avoid it. Maybe you will be able, that would be great, and you will turn around a factory or turn around a business that will avoid to have some layoff. But take care of people. In whatever situations, the good and the bad one, take care of people. Pay attention to them. They are the most important one. Thank you very much.